Hello, my name is Eran. I'm a motion designer and content creator. I'm based in the UK. I still don't have an English accent. I'm working on it. And I'm in love with After Effects, just to be honest. I'm working with the application for the last 25 years and teaching it for the last two decades, actually spending more time with After Effects than with my wife. I'm not sure that I'm allowed to say it. But like in two words, this is what I do in life. I fight ugliness, not in the real world, but on the screen, right? So I'll try to do it here as well. And this is an elevator brief, just to make sure that you are in the right room. High expectation or great expectations, this is what we'll do. In this session, you will learn how to work faster and smarter and become a power user of After Effects. Who doesn't want to be a power user? Right? All of us, right? So yes, yes, you will be. I will make you cry. So it doesn't matter if you just met the application today, you're working with it like for the last 4 years, maybe, I don't know, more. I promise I will teach you at least one thing that you didn't know. Maybe two things. We'll see. All right, so here are the topics. This is what's in the agenda. I'll start with some, you know, shallow waters. We'll cover some interface customization and keyboard shortcuts, things that everyone can take to the next After Effects party and brag. And then I'll show you how to make After Effects even faster than what it is today. And I will speak with Photoshop and Illustrator and ask for help. And I'll show you how well they integrate together, really, really well. And I'm also going to, this is a spoiler, I'm going to use XD to show you something that really, you'll blow your mind. I'll speak about text animation, and if time allows, hopefully I'm not too ambitious, I'll show you some compositing techniques. So these are my slides. Believe it or not, I'm working on air. If you're not getting my jokes, don't sweat about it. So this is After Effects. This is After Effects with an open project, and we are going to start making some clearance and order. So I know that you're anxious to see what I have here. I promise I'm going to show it to you. But for now, let's just make sure that if you are opening the application, both you and I will be on the same page. Now, this is not a lab. I'm just, you know, offering some advice when you start working with it. So the first thing here is that I'm actually going to double-click on the default workspace. And by workspace, I mean the arrangements of panels. So we've got a couple of panels. This is a cool trick to just reset it quickly without digging into any other menus. Now, it really wants you to press no, but I'm going to say yes, because I want to reset it. Now, the thing is that, you know, each one of us has his own, like, you know, preferences. So for example, you may not like the libraries. You may want to work with the character panel and maybe the paragraph panel, but look at that. Every time that I'm clicking on something, the other one goes away, which is so annoying. So you know what? We will force it to stay. I'm going to click on this option menu. And over here, under panel group settings, you have the option to de-solo, with a lack of another description, the panel solo stack. So this means that now, if I'm going to open other panels in this arrangement, they will stay. They will not go away. Now, this is just one way to work, of course. After Effects, like here, is a democratic country. You can do whatever you want. And you can save your layout and do other stuff. So let me show you an example why you want to change this layout. I'm going to go to this marker, where I have like a couple of layers here. And let's say that I want to mess or deal or color correct this castle. So I'll click on it because I'm a clicker. And, you know, doesn't work. Oh my God, I've opened another layer. This is exactly not what I wanted to do. So I can hunt for the layer over here, or I can just hover on top of it, right click, and under this menu, there's a select menu. And this is going to show you everything under your mouse. So in this case, if you are compulsive like me and you named your layers, you will be able to just select whatever you wanted. In this case, the lovely castle. And I would like to go to the effect menu. After effect, after all, it's after effect. And I'm going to go to the color correction, and I'll add the levels effect. And the reason that I'm doing it is not only because I want to change the gamma, this is it, is because this is really annoying, because I can't see the entire histogram. So I may want to just, you know, give it a little bit more space, and then play with this, something along those lines. Now, let's assume that I like this workspace with everything that I've modified. Of course, you can continue to do whatever you want, and you want to save it as a new one, or maybe just override this one. If this is the case, go to Window, Workspace, and then you have those options. So you can edit the workspace, you can create a new one, you can do basically whatever you want with this. So I'm going to save a new workspace, I'm going to name it Design, and say okay. And this way, Design, and take a look at it, defaults are the same thing now. Just because After Effects is like the bathroom, it remembers how you set the warm and cold water. So if you don't want this behavior, you already know the answer. Double click, this is going to reset to the factory default. And now I've got my design workspace, which is different from the default one, all right? So obviously I've got like script one, which is using a couple of third-party scripts, just to show you that this is not something that I'm doing in front of you. I'm actually using this in my real life. All right, so I'm just going to go back to, let's say, the design, just because we got used to it and it's so lovely. And let's say that I want to mess with this guy. I'm just going to zoom in and zoom out. And you know what? Let me just run you through some of what I consider to be an important keyboard shortcuts. Now, you can write everything that I'm saying, but I'm going to give you a slide to summarize it all. So you just, you know, prepare your mobile phone. And when I'm going to give you the cue, you can just click. All right. For now, the most important keyboard shortcut, at least to my opinion, is the grave or tilde key. So anytime that I'm hovering on top of one of After Effects panels and I'm pressing it, and usually on American keyboards it's near the digit one, but since I'm using a mobile machine, this is near the Z or Z. Or Zod, if you're coming from a DC universe. Anyhow, I'm going to press the grave or tilde key, and this is going to maximize this panel, and I can do it to any other panel because space here is precious, and very quickly things become very crowded, so it's more of a custom to do this once in a while. Now, if you want to get really close and personal to your layers, then you can, of course, zoom in and zoom out. Now, everybody here in this room knows that Command plus or Control plus will do this the same. The opposite will be Control or Command minus, depending on your OS. But you can also do it with the period and the comma key, right? So the period or the greater than will zoom you in, and the key next to it, which is the comma, will zoom you out. Now, this is great if I want to deal with the castle, but let's say that I really want to give some love to this dragon. Right, so I'm just moving into the castle and not into the dragon. So this tip is actually applicable to any application that starts with the word Adobe. You need to hold down the option, this will be the Alt key, and use your mouse scroller, and this will zoom you in to where your mouse is located, which is the way you will zoom from this day onward. All right, so this is just between you and me, of course. Now, this is zooming into the composition panel. What if we want to zoom into the timeline to, let's say, the maximum amount, which is frames? So if this is the case, then you can press the semicolon key. So anytime that I'm going to press this semicolon key, I'm going to maximize the zoom here in the timeline so I can really deal with like tiny resolutions when I'm working with keyframes, etc. Now, I know that you're very curious to see what it's all about. I'm going to play to you in a moment. I'm just going to, you know, build for it. So this is what we have. I'm going to click on this pop-up menu, and I'm going to switch to a working view, which is custom view one. And you will see that since I'm using 3D in After Effects in its default state, I'm basically using 3D cards in space. So if I press C, which is another common keyboard shortcut, this will activate this tool over here, which is the Unified Camera tool. This is super quick, this is a super cool tool. Like, they've got a couple of other tools underneath, but I'm going to assume that you have a brand new mouse with at least three buttons. So the left one will help you to orbit around the scene, all right? The right one is tracking into the scene. And the middle one, which I'm failing to click because I haven't bought a new mouse. Anyhow, the middle one is pan up and down. So another leap of faith here. I'm going to also zoom out by pressing shift and question mark or the forward slash. And then if I want to switch back to the camera, obviously I can, you know, switch tools and go all the way over here, but this is too much work. Instead, I'm going to press the escape key. So escape will toggle between the last two views that were active. How many of you learned at least one new thing? Like, you know, but this is just the first 5 minutes, so great, great, great. It will be much better. All right, a couple of other stuff that are very important is to select and deselect layers, which is super common, but I'm just going to show you. You've got this option over here under the edit to deselect all. This is obviously Command-Shift-A, but you can also press F2. Very easy function key. This is very useful because sometimes we need to create vectors and stuff inside After Effects. And you need to make sure that nothing is selected. Another thing which is worth remembering, I'm going to click on this dragon layer, is how can I see what I did to this? So I've got obviously some animation going on. And to see this animation, I can go to the animation menu and reveal properties with keyframes, or I can tell myself, you, what I did, all right? So you will show you the keyframes that you created. And you can see that those keyframes are linear keyframes. Or you need to believe me, because those diamonds keyframes, these are linear keyframes. Which means that if I'm going to take my playhead, place it over here, then press the letter B for the beginning of the work area, and then go over here and press the letter N to define the end of the working area, and then press spacebar, I will be able to show you at least part or trailer from this tiny animation, and you can get a sense of what I meant by saying that those are linear keyframes, which are for babies. We want some smoothness. So actually, smoothness is for babies. Never mind. I'm going to mark here around all of those guys. And one of your dearest friends is F9. Once again, I want to show you the menu items. So this is almost like automating After Effects, asking it to go over the animation menu, then go to the keyframe assistant and initiate this command, which is easy ease. So from this day onward, F9, and you will get different icons here in the timeline that will hopefully give you a hint that this is what you are doing. All right, so enough with keyframes. Sorry, not keyframes. Keyframes will be there. But enough with keyboard shortcuts. I just want to summarize it, and here is the slide. So the key, the most important one, is tilde. I'm going to maximize it. And here are all the things that I just told you about, plus a couple of bonus stuff. All right, I'm going to give you some few more moments to take a snapshot. And let's say, just because we are so intimate in this room, that one of these keyframes offended you, right? You don't, keyboard shortcut once again, you don't agree with the default settings, just going to hide it. You can change wherever you want. So you can go to the edit menu, and you can go to keyboard shortcuts, and you can map the entire After Effects keyboard shortcut, which is a relatively new feature. This came out a couple of years ago, which is super cool. But the thing is, that how will you know what is being taken and what not? For example, I'm going to cancel out of this for a moment, and I'm going to right-click on this dragon layer, and from the reveal options, this is a context menu, I really want to create a keyboard shortcut for this one. Reveal layer source in the project. I want to see where it is buried under all the folders. And for some reason, this is not coming with a keyboard shortcut. So all I need to do is go back to the same thing that I just showed you. So keyboard shortcuts menu under the edit command. Over here, you've got a search option. Just start to type the word reveal. And with any luck, you will see your options. So in this case, this is it. Now, I'm going to highlight these shortcuts options. And then let's say that I'm going to hold down the Alt or Option key. After Effects will tell me what are the available keys that have not been used. So I can just click on, let's say, R, which for me makes sense. So Alt or option R. And from this day onwards, until I will do something else, this is going to go with me, because this is one of those settings that save with your project in your Creative Cloud account. So this is like a user settings. It's across the entire After Effects experience, like we are in a theme park. All right, so let me just show you what this does. I'm just going to close this and then press Alt or Option R. And this is one of the gotchas in After Effects. Believe me, I'm pressing it. Nothing happens. After Effects is one of those applications which everything is very context. So you need to make sure that the panel that you want to activate whatever you did is active, and then you can initiate whatever you want to do. So only then you can right-click and, you know, see this is the shortcut that I've created. I just want to show you that After Effects also added to the menu, right? Make sense? Perfect sense to me, but I just want to make sure. All right, so I'm going to collapse this guy and this. Just I don't want to bore you with all of my madness here. I'm going to press F2 to deselect all. Double-click on this work area. Go to the beginning and start to cache those frames. And you will see that After Effects is going to struggle with it because there are tons of stuff here. There's depth of field, there's 3D layers, there's a lot of effects and what have you. So there is a way to make After Effects more faster, and it is waiting for you patiently near this rocket icon. So if you're coming from Illustrator, this should be familiar. If I'm going to click on this, it's actually going to launch the project settings, which you can find under the file, of course. And then, depending on your OS, you will be able to activate a GPU, graphic processor unit, acceleration. So I'm on the Mac, I'm going to choose the metal one. If you're on the PC, you're probably going to see something else, your CUDA, which is actually better. I'm going to say OK, and then After Effects is going to clear the green things here, which were the cache files. And then I'm going to go back to where I was, press spacebar, and it's going to be almost in real time. So it's going to chew through the same thing with probably twice as fast as before. So if you just came for one tip, which is just speed, this is it for you. You can go, I'm not going to be insulted, but I've got plenty of other stuff for you. For example, I'm just going to pause the playback for a moment, and this is the last thing that we are going to do here, but I think it is going to be very appreciated by you. You see these tiny anchor points of the mask? How many times you're trying to like select it and it just selects something else? So instead of like selecting this anchor point, After Effects decided that I actually wanted both of them. And this is because it's so tiny and I'm so far away and I can't do anything. So actually I can. I can go to the preferences menu, which on the PC side is under the edit, go to general, and then there is this option over here, the first one that everyone missed, which is path point and handle size. I'm going to raise it just for the sake of this demonstration to 10, say okay, and suddenly we are back in business. I can actually see what I'm doing. And once again, this is a free democratic country, so if the yellow, it doesn't work for you, double click on the mask chip and select any color from the color picker. All right, moving on. I'm going to double click on this composition where I have something which is half-baked. Actually, it doesn't do anything. It's just a Photoshop layer. So just to give you some context, this is part of a commercial that was created by Prometheus. This is a studio, a post house in Tel Aviv that I used to work with. And it used, and this is a commercial for a streamer that can record multiple channels at the same time. And what we are looking here, obviously, is an illustration of two programs that you can TiVo and save yourself some fighting with the wife. And this is the good wife, of course. So this is a Photoshop document. I'm going to go to the edit menu, and I'm going to ask After Effects to edit the original, which is going to launch Photoshop. On my machine, it was already running in the background. So I was just switched to the application. And I know that now you feel very comfortable and calm. So let's just watch this for a moment. No, I'm just joking. You can see there are layers here, right? And there are a couple of smart objects. Everybody feel comfortable with smart objects? And as well as folders. Oops, sorry. And inside those folders, there's live text. And I want control and I want access to everything inside After Effects. So it's no secret that I can re-import this file and do the entire thing again and create a composition out of it. You already knew this, I'm sure. But did you know that you can right-click, go to the Create menu, and just convert this guy to a layered composition? So I'm going to do it again. Right-click, Create, Convert to Layered Comp. And this is going to import everything that you need. I'm just going to close it. I'm going to double-click. And there you go. We just created a composition out of a flattened image. And this is true for Illustrator as well. I'm here to prove it to you. Later, not now. So see, everything survived this journey, blending modes as well as folders, which are now pre-compositions. So this is those two text layers that we've just seen. I'm going to return to this in a moment, but I will switch back to Photoshop just so you'll know. I just want to emphasize this. This guy is a smart object, right? So if I'm going to double click on it, it will open up another PSB layer, which stands for Photoshop Big File, okay, in case you want to know. And you have access to all the other stuff here. So these things is basically collapsed and converted automatically to pixels when you bring them into After Effects. You don't have access to this. You must have Photoshop in order to change it. So let's make this guy a little bit more of a feminine character by colorizing his shirt to pink. I'm going to save this, and this is going to update here in Photoshop, which makes perfect sense, right? So if I'm going to call After Effects, nothing happened. I'm going to just make sure that the info panel is on screen, and I'm also going to switch to the standard workspace just because I know it better than everybody else. I just love the standard workspace. All right, so take a look at the info panel. Nothing is happening. In order for After Effects to understand that something happened, you must save the document. You see this asterisk, this tells you that the document hasn't been saved. All right, we saved the smart object, but I must save this guy, and then it will reread everything, and it will update it. So if I'm going to go back to Photoshop, undo, press save, and return to After Effects, I'm back at square one. So just know this thing with the smart object. So I undid the operation, meaning that now I've got like two versions, a little bit confusing, but it's something that you need to bear in mind. Now let's go back to those texts. I'm going to actually show you how easy it is to animate this Photoshop multi-layered file and why the integration between those two applications is the number one feature when you are reading like, you know, something inside the Adobe website. This is always number one, integration between other Adobe applications. I'm here to prove it to you. So let's switch back to After Effects. I double click on this Mad Max comp, and here we are. We have these two layers. Just a recap, those are live text here inside Photoshop. Here they are just regular pixel-based layers. But you can right click on them, and from the same Create Lovely menu, now you have the option to convert these to an editable text. So assuming you have the font installed, which I have, then it will be converted to an editable text. But for those of you with a sharp eye, it's not exactly the same because I've manipulated the text inside Photoshop. I used some of the new fancy warping tools. So in this case, I skewed the text and After Effects doesn't have a clue what I did. So super easy, I need to just know what I did, which is, you know, the human factor. We still need human. I'm going to select one of them just to show you. And then for every text layer inside After Effects, you have this animate menu, which will have all the options that you need in the world. So I'm going to add the skew thing that I need. I'm going to type in 8, and then I'm going to select this animator, select the other one, and paste it. Now why I did the whole number of converting them to live text? Because I can actually animate or use the per character text engine inside After Effects, which is super complicated and way beyond the scale of this session. But I will show you how you can utilize it thanks to animation presets. So here in the effects and presets, if I'm going to drill down this folder, you got dozens, if not hundreds, if not thousands, if not 10,000 of presets. Some of them are showing their age, but others are very, very useful. For example, if I'm going to like open up the 3D text, I've got tons of stuff. Now, how would I know which one to use? Of course, they have descriptive names, right? Central spiral, decoder fade in, etc. But here is another way to work, just in case you want a visual representation. Select the text that you want to apply, whatever animation. Go to the animation menu and choose Browse Presets. For a moment, it would look like nothing is happening, but actually, a new application should launch. Let's see if this is happening. Yes, it is jumping here, which is Adobe Bridge, which is a bridge, which is a browser, which means that it now looks at the same folder inside After Effects. You don't need to do anything but what I've shown you. I'm going to double-click on the text, and then double-click on one of these, and then you will have a visual representation. Now, if you're working on the PC, this is also going to be animated. For some reason, Apple is blocking it. I don't know why. It doesn't really matter. We are not here to defend Apple. We're going to go back to here, and I'm actually going to use some of the presets that I know that works nice here, just because I think that you got the deal. So let's just start to type in stretch, yes. And I'm going to go with the first one, double click to apply it. Actually, I can undo, select both of them to save me some time, and then apply this animation to the both of the layers. This is too slow, but I can tell myself you what I did, right? And reveal the keyframes. I'm going to click here, press 15 to go to frame number 15, select these guys, take them over here, select these ones, create some sort of a cascade animation, and then I have this thing going on with less than 10 seconds, including my narration. So if I'm going to climb one level up to the main composition, I already have something that I can write home about. Well, not really. I'm going to go and select the Tom Hardy layer, and I'm going to show you that if you don't like to animate with keyframes, you can also express keyframe using an expression. And there is great behavior category here under the effects and presets. So for example, I'm going to select this guy, drift over time. Now, the layer is selected, the preset is selected. So I can double click, and this is going to apply the preset. I'm going to just press space bar to see what it does, and it drifts over time. So I don't need to worry about this. Everything in parentheses is just not my concern, and not yours as well. And I'm just going to look for the magic angle, which I happen to know because I have a sixth sense when it comes to this project. So 81 should work. And then I can play with the speed. So let's take it to, let's say, 15. Go to the beginning. And without doing any real wiggling here, we are at the beginning stage of a very quick animation from a still file. Now, I know that it is very tempting to sit here and continue to watch me work, but I'm going to save you this pleasure by double-clicking on this final composition, and I'll show you what we have here. So I did the same thing for the other layers, and I've also added some whooshes. I'll show you in a moment what they are looking like, and let's also take this to full screen. So this is something that probably will take you a bit more of work, like maybe 10 or 15 minutes. But once again, once you have a good stationary design, the animation is also going to look quite nice. And what we are seeing over here, just in case you are wondering, is just one frame animation. Like this is the basic of the basic to create those lines. And you can find them, by the way, on the internet floor, free to get for everyone. Or you can just buy them if you want like premium packages. There are so many presets for After Effects. It's just unbelievable. Is everybody still with me? There's a little bit of a quiet here. So either you get everything or not getting nothing. I don't know. Are we good to go? Excellent. All right. So I'll double click on 03 wrappers. All right. Recognize this guy? This is an amazing illustration by my dear friend Chen Maccabi. This is how you should pronounce it. Anyhow, I'm going to select this. This is an Illustrator file. We're going to do the same number, the same move that we did before, this time from the keyboard. So Command or Control E. This is going to launch Illustrator. This is going to show you the illustration. Make sure, by the way, that if you're working with After Effects under File, Document Color Mode, you are in the RGB world, right? After Effects is a screen application. You may see a different colors or different behaviors if you're bringing CMYK document. This is true for Photoshop as well, but this is not the tip. I'm going to show you that we have a couple of layers here. Let's just expand them so you'll see there are like text and tons of lines. All right. Let's go back to After Effects. Let's do the same thing that we did before. Right-click on this, create, convert to layered comp, double-click. Here we have all the three layers. So the same deal with Illustrator, super cool. But it is not enough for me, right? It's not enough. I really want to get access to all the anchor points, to all the vectors inside this file. And since both of them can talk with each other, there is actually a command here. I'm going to select this guy just to show you. You know what? Let's just select everything. I'm going to be brave or stupid. Who knows? Let's see what happens. I'm going to select all three layers, and then I'm going to right-click. And under Create, you can actually create native vector files or shape layers, as they are known inside After Effects, from these vector layers. So if I'm going to select this command, After Effects will switch off the visibility for the previous one, and it will give me a poor man version of what was a beautiful illustration a moment ago. Now, you can argue that this is better, but I'm not going to agree. I also lost the text here for some reason because I didn't convert it to outlines. Poor me, right? I want a live text. And, you know, this, I just want to show you why I'm doing this. I'm doing this because if you are working with native shape layers here inside After Effects, you can actually expand them, and under the Add, you can add mathematical operations. This is the correct terminology, which is, let's go with Dream Path. And this, if I'm just going to change it, will create these nice reveals. But of course, this is completely irrelevant because I just destroyed the entire thing. So I'm going to show you something that if you haven't seen before, you are going to cry, as I promised before. So prepare the tissues. It's coming. I'm going to ask XD, which is the experience design, for help. I'm going to launch it. Wait for a moment. Now, don't be alarmed. You don't need to know anything about XD. The only thing that you need to know is your computer. Okay? Click your computer, navigate to the same file. This is it. Click Open to open it in Adobe XD. Wait for XD to think about it. Let's just maximize it so you'll get a sense. You know what? Let's not maximize it. I hate when this is happening. All right, so I'm going to say Command or Control A. This is Select All. And then I'm going to go for File, Export, After Effects. And then the magic is happening. Look at that. Everything. I mean, everything survived, even the locked layers. The textures are here. The text is live. I can do whatever I want. It is such a good day today. Now, the only thing that you need to pay attention is that if I'm going to go to the composition settings, XD really wants you to create 1 minute compositions. This is the thing with XD. So I'm just going to highlight this, press 3 period to create a 3 second composition. And I may or may not want 60 frames per second. I don't. I'm going to set it to something which is more in the video world, so 24 or something along those lines. And then I'm going to say OK. Now, note this is going to create one of the famous names inside After Effects, Comp1. All right, so you do need to rename it to something else, unless you're happy with Comp1. But let me show you a couple of things that you can do with it, because this is so cool. And of course, I'm going to show you in a moment a final version, but just so you'll see why we went through the trouble, which is not so big of trouble, to create this. So let's start with those texts that we have over here. I'm going to select Mr. Kendrick Lamar here. Let's just zoom so we'll see what we are doing. I'm going to hold and press the space bar just to make sure that we see everything. Close this, go to the effects and presets, start to type down 3D rain, which should isolate this lovely preset, and double click in order to apply it. Press space bar, and just like that, we have something which looks very cool. Nobody understands what I did, but it still looks very cool. Basically, I applied an animation preset that was included inside After Effects, and let me show you what else you can do if you like this workflow. Let's go back to the beginning, select the name of the album here, and I'm going to start to type exposure. Now here you need to be careful. You've got an effect name exposure, but I'm after the animation preset exposure, which belongs to the lights and optical category. Double click to apply it, space bar to see what I did. Marvelous. I'm going to select the other layer here to give credit to the illustrator. And I'm going to use probably my favorite, not over the top preset, which is word processor, right? This is similar thing to typewriter, but for grown-ups. So I'll show you what it does. I'll make sure that I'm at the beginning. I'll double click. And let me see if you can catch it. It gives you this lovely cursor, which is blinking. Can you see it? And if this is not good enough for you, you can change the speed of the blinking. So I don't know. I just think this is amazing. And of course, if you want it to be a little bit faster or slower, press U. You only need to mess with those two keyframes. And that's it for the text. All right. But this is not the big deal. The big deal is the thing that I can do with all of those shapes. Since I meticulously named them in Illustrator, they actually appear here with the same naming. So I maximized, by the way, the After Effects timeline by pressing the tilde or grave key. I think this is safe to say that everyone knows. And I'm going to use this index search over here because I only want to work on the face features. So this is why you should name your layers. I'm going to select the face, face contour. Let's go to the beginning. Once again, we'll ask for the trim path help. I'm going to drill it down, create a keyframe for the end value. And when in doubt, let's just go to 1 second and animate the thing. I'm going to preview it. And of course, it's doing the nice animation, but the wrong direction, which is not so much of a big deal. And you may think that if you'll do the other way around, like animate the start, it will fix it, but I'm here to tell you no. What you actually need to do is collapse and expand this and click on this guy. Reverse path direction on for some reason. And this is not working, but it should work. So usually it works. If you tried it in your hotel late at night, it works in front of 1,000 people, doesn't work, but I'll assume that it is working and, you know, you're happy with this direction because you're not really my director. All right, so I'm just going to take this one. I'm going to select this stroke. This is just a redundant effect. Let's go once again over here. And because we can, this is completely optional. I'm going to use the page turn effect. Cheesy one, but still, look at this. All right, I'm not going to do this, really. I'm actually going to double-click on the final because if you invest more time in it, it can actually look like this, which is very, very easy to pull off thanks to XD. We all need to thank XD for that. This is the thing. I mean, if you haven't installed it, do it just for this. And, of course, you can do another great things with it. It's an amazing application. I'm just teasing. All right, ready to move on?
I have a question.
Yes, question.
Can you just import a composition that AI file and keep everything in line?
The question was, can I import it as a composition from Illustrator? Well, I actually did, and it didn't work because I'm only going to get those three layers which are in the top hierarchy over here in the layers panel. This is somewhat of a limitation between Illustrator and After Effects. Now, there are third-party tools, like Overlord, that can save you the trouble. But this is, you know, you need to reach into your pockets. You know what I mean? Not that it's a bad investment, but this is free. This is built in. Yes?
Sometimes when you convert from Adobe Illustrator layer to a shape, it misses up your anchor points and animation if you already did something. Is there a way to keep everything as is?
Right. I'm going to repeat the question. The question was, when you import something or convert it from Illustrator, sometimes when it is reaching the After Effects stage, the anchor point, which is the middle of the shape, got confused and there's like a complete madness. And the answer is yes, XD will respect the same anchor points that you set up inside Illustrator. So this is actually going to solve you this problem as well.
That's helpful, but I meant inside, you already imported, you're inside After Effects, you did some motion and keyframes, then you wanted to convert this Illustrator layer into a shape.
All right, so I'm sorry, but come see me after, and I'll expand on this, because this is like a completely different path now. We're just going to lose our way if we're going to take this. It's an interesting question, I'm not ignoring you, but I need to make sure that I'm sticking to the plan. I've got some wonderful stuff to show. If there will be time, I'll return to this and answer. So, okay, are we cool? All right, same goes for everyone else that had the question. So keep it for yourself for now, and then I'll give you some time at the end. All right, next thing that I want to show you is these funny guys. And I actually want to show you that you can not only create them very easily, but also animate them automatically with zero knowledge in animation. You only need After Effects and Illustrator, of course, right? So Creative Cloud subscription. So, I'm going to select one of these and press Command E, just, you know, so we will be taken to Illustrator. And I'm going to switch off the visibility. And let's start fresh by creating a new layer. And I'm going to, before actually selecting the type tool, I'll go to the type menu and I'll call the glyphs panel. This is very important. I want the glyphs panel to be visible on screen. And I'm also going to click, I already did it, so usually it becomes super tiny, like microscopic. So I'm just clicking several times on these little mountains or big mountains to make sure that I see everything. Now, over here, where it says whatever it says, I'm going to type emoji or beginning, or start to type the word emoji. And this is going to launch the emoji one font, which is installed without your permission on every computer that uses Creative Cloud, which is super great. Look at all of these guys. Much better designed than WhatsApp and Facebook. And these are all vector files. Oh my God, let me show you what you can do. I'm going to take the text tool, click over here, make sure that we'll start with, let's say, 200 points. And I'll double-click on the robot here. I'll scroll down. I know that everyone has his favorite, but I have something in mind. So bear with me. Enjoy the show. We are the Blowfish. All right. And we're going to thank and say goodbye to this panel. So now I'm going to hold Shift and scale them. These are vectors. So I think that a bulb is like lighting on top of your head. If not, it should. I want to bring it to After Effects. I can't copy and paste. I need to actually create outlines from this. So right click, create outlines. Now it's vectors. I pressed Command or Control Y. So I can bring them over to After Effects and I will have access to all the individual shapes. I can move through XD, but I don't need to. It's actually going to work perfect in this case. Now, the thing is that if you want access to each one of them on its own, then you need to separate them. So this is what I did here. So right now, what we have is just those two shapes. I need to actually make sure that each one of these is a layer on its own. So just to show you, it's a little bit of a housekeeping thing, but you need to do it. Otherwise, it won't work. So I'm going to shift select it. I'm going to make sure that they are here at the top floor. Then I'm going to select the layer which hosts them. Okay, so this is just one layer now. Go to the option menu here inside Illustrator and tick this command, release to layers in parentheses sequence, because we want to create a sequence out of it. I don't have any logical explanation. This is it. Build is for flash or animate. So this is going to, it looks like nothing has happened, but it's actually converted those groups to layers. So now each one of these can be dragged outside because it is an independent layer. You can see layer one, layer two. Before it was just groups, it was path, collections of path. We must have layers if you want After Effects to be able to extract them, expand them, convert them to vectors. Make sense? All right, this is how it works. Obviously, I did all of this before, so you know, this is just to show you how you should work. I'm just going to delete it, make sure our dear friends are still visible, and I'm going to bring back After Effects because they are already here. Okay, and I already took the time and the liberty and split them to two different layers, which means that now I can select both of them and I can right click and I can choose create and I can create shapes from vector layers. And this is going to do two things. It's going to switch off the visibility for the original vector art, which I don't need, but I can use always as a reference. And it will create native files or native vector files. And I just want to maximize it and show you that even without the dear help of XD, we still have access to everything here. So think about After Effects as a mini Illustrator. You can actually have access to all the individual paths and groups that you've created. This is, for example, this, whatever you want to call it, on the blowfish head. All right? So what we can do with it, I mean, this is great that we have it, right? I'm first going to select those two layers, and since I don't want them in my way, I'm going to enable the shy switch for them. So this means that I can click on the master shy switch, and they will be gone. They are still there if I need to reference them in the future, but they are not bothering me. I'm compulsive. Everything bothers me. So they are not bothering me anymore. Now I can select, let's start with the blowfish, and I'm going to expand it, and I'm going to, and you don't need to look at all of these layers, you just need to make sure the contents is selected because we want to apply one of these path operations. And I'm just going to show you what's possible, but at the end, I'm already going to spoil it for you and tell you this is what we're going to use. But just so you see what you have here, let's go, for example, with pucker and bloat. Right? This is something that you have in Illustrator as well. So you can do this thing. All right? Not so useful, but you can. I'm going to go back to over this, over here, and ask for wiggle path. We need to zoom in to actually see what this guy is doing. And I'm just going to press spacebar. And this is going to take each one of the paths and wiggle it. And of course, if this is not your taste, then you've got few options to choose from. So you can do whatever you like here. You can, you know, make it bigger, spikier, scarier, what have you. All right, what else you can do? You know what, let's just switch off the visibility for this guy so it won't be in our way. You can twist. I think this is understandable. One of my favorite, you can repeat the shape. Okay? So you can apply a repeater. And for the repeater, you have its own transformation. So this means, sorry, so this means that I can say, let's say 12 copies. And I'm going to move the entire shape just so you can see it. And of course, now I can change these things, I can scale them. I can rotate them. And everything that has a stopwatch near the name can be animated. I can even fade it in or out, can create a completely free aquarium of this blowfish. But the real, I think, cool things that you can do. In this case, something which will make more sense, I'm just going to bring it to where it was, is to apply the wiggle transform. Now, when you apply the wiggle transform, at the beginning it won't do anything. So I'm just moving the timeline, nothing is happening. This can be frustrating, but this is just because you need to understand that the wiggle transform has its own transformation. So you actually need to drill this one down, and then you need to give it some values. How many pixels or degrees or scale values or a percentage you want it to move. So for example, if I'm going to do this thing, just for example, very little, like, you know, mild changes will take you a long way here, and press spacebar, it's actually going to wiggle the shapes which were inside. Now, obviously, you can do it to anything that you are bringing from Illustrator. This is just a lovely and very happy example. So I'm going to enable this one. And notice that After Effects is still playing. This is an uninterrupted preview. This is relatively new. And at the same time that it is playing, I can continue to work. I don't need to pause and wait for it. I can actually add to the shape, if I know what I'm doing, the wiggle transform. I don't need to stop the preview. I can open the transformation over here. Maybe give this guy a little bit more freedom. And you know, you can do whatever you like. This is a bit crazy, but it's funny. So almost Bender, but not really. All right, cool, warm, just in the middle. Wow, we have plenty of time, excellent. So, I'm going to move on. And this is just me saying we are doing very good with time, because time is going to end up very soon. So, compositing. Here is something that I think most of you will do or are doing at some point, which is eliminating the green background, right? So I just want to show you what we have here. These clips are courtesy of Adobe Stock. So this very lovely girl. And underneath, we have the particles here. All right, I'm just going to close this. So I want to create a convincing composite and show you how you can also maintain all the fine hair details that we have here, which is a little bit more trickier than you may expect. So let's start with the obvious thing. I'm going to select the girl, go to the effect category or window or menu, sorry, and under this category, under King, I'll start with the key light effect. Now, key light is a plugin which is shipping with After Effects. So it used to be on its own, it used to be very expensive. It is a program inside the program. You know, these days, After Effects and Photoshop are basically an operating system that can run other applications inside. So this is one example. But you get it for free, and it's very, very powerful. Now, you don't need to know anything about green screen. This is the beauty with Keylight. It's actually one of the fastest tools that will get you 90% of the way if you are not afraid to take this picker and click on the green color. Right? Already, without doing anything, it looks amazing. But is it? I'm going to check under this pop-up menu the screen matte, which is similar to a layer mask in Photoshop. So you can see, hopefully, I'm not sure if you can, that this is not a perfect matte. And if you don't see it, then take a look over here at the info panel. When I'm moving my mouse, it's telling me that these values are not actually 0, 0, 0. This should be complete transparency. And over here, where there should be like complete opaque, we have some leftovers. So we need to switch the, or actually expand the screen matte controls. And we have a built-in levels effect here. So we can clip the black and we can clip the white to make the matte, which is another fancy name to alpha channel, a better to behave better for us. So I'm going to click and drag until, you don't need to go too far in this case. Once again, I'm going to measure with the mouse. I see that it's all set to 0, which means I've got full transparency here. And then I'm going to take this guy, to the opposite value or to the opposite direction. Now, the secret here or the recipe here is that between these numbers, you should have at least 70 values, right? So if you want to be certain that you're not cutting too much from the shot, you're not trimming your talent, you need to subtract this value from this one or this from this, depending on what you are doing, and make sure that you have a leverage of 70 units. It's not pixels, so I'm just going to name it units. All right? Now, if I'm going to take a look at the final result, it looks much better. Maybe you can't see the difference, but trust me, it looks much better. The problem here is that we're actually losing a lot of the hair definition. And just to show you, this is what we had before. We had a lot of stuff, very fine details in the hair, and I wanted to show you a very nice method of how to preserve this. And this is almost a recipe, so we are going to bake a cake inside After Effects, so to say. Forgive my metaphor, it's not funny, it's not relevant. So, I'm going to select the layer, I'm going to press Command or Control D to duplicate another copy. So now I've got two of them. I'm going to select the lower one, and just so you'll see what I'm doing, I'll click the solo switch here, which will isolate it in place, right? So we're just looking at this guy. This is the transparency grid. Everyone should feel comfortable with what I'm showing. If not, let me know. I'm here for you. This is not just me talking. But I'm assuming that you're okay with it. I'm going to go over here. I'm still using Keylight. The screen mat is still expanded. And I'm actually going to use this screen shrink grow as well as screen softness. So I'm going to start to expand it until I see that I'm getting all the hair, all the fine details, in my case around 140 should do the trick. So now I'm including everything, right? It's gray, but I'm including everything. Now, whatever value you are getting here, you need to basically type it one floor down. So where it says screen softness, if I get to 140, just type in 140 over here. And this will create some sort of a softness, of course, a feather-like. So now this is what we have. I'm going to unsolo the file. We have this gray extra pixels, and we have what we consider to be a great mat. So now this is the trick. I'm going to use blending mode here. Now, in case you can't see them, this is where they are hiding. This is a little switch here, which will expand or collapse the transfer controls. It's not called blending mode because you've got a couple of other options. And if Photoshop blending mode weren't enough here, you have much more to choose from. But we are going to go old school, sort to say, and we are actually going to go with one of the overlay family blending mode. And in this case, the winning one, to my opinion, is linear light. So I'm just going to select linear light, and I'm going to show you the before and after, just so you'll see. Now, this is just too strong. So I'll press T for opacity. Okay, this is the shortcut. And I'll turn it down to, let's say, 50%. Now, once again, let's just zoom in, and I'll switch it on and off. And you can see that we are preserving all of those fine details that were lost in whatever space or transparency, just because we were too careless with Keylight. So this should work 99% of the time. I'm not going to say every time, because every footage is different, and you may have different colors and stuff. But when you have these kind of problems with fine details and fine hair, try this method. Now, the problem that I have with it, it's really working great. I'm just going to press play to show you a few frames, is that it's not really believable yet. Meaning that it doesn't really look connected. So I need to create some sort of a match between the foreground and the background. So once again, there are plenty of ways to do it. Here is my advice. I'm going to pause the playback. Take the background, duplicate it, so I have another copy. Bring it above all the rest. So now I have one above, one underneath, and sandwiched in between the pretty girl. And then I'm going to go to Effect, Blur and Sharpen, Fast Box Blur, and I'll be generous. I'll start with 25%. percent or values or whatever it is. So the bigger the value, the more blur you have, obviously. And if you want, you can also repeat the edge pixels. This is completely optional. So we are blurring the background, nothing special. Now I'm going to go back to the effect menu, and under the channel category, I'm going to apply the set matte effect, which is another way to take transparency from another layer, right? So this is a compound effect. It asks me here, let's just expand it so you can see. These are the layers that I see in your timeline. Where do you want to take the matte or the alpha channel? So I'm going to take it from the first layer, which was the one without the softness. Now, the thing is that if I'm doing it like so, nothing will happen. You will see that it really doesn't work. And the reason is because this layer has an effect to it. Remember, key light is an effect. So I must use the second pop-up menu here and tell the effect that I want to use the effects and masks. I don't have any masks, but I have an effect. So effectively, this is what I'm creating if I'm just going to solo this layer. I'm creating a silhouette which has the blurred version of the background inside. Right? Makes sense? So all I need to do now after I have this set up is select the layer and choose the color blending mode to match the colors. Now, I took it too far. So as before, press T for opacity and just play with it until it looks good. So let's go, I don't know, with 40 or 41%. So this is the before and this is after. Before and after. You may not see a big difference. So I'm here to show you another great tip. You can replace the footage. Now, I'm certain that you know how to replace the footage in After Effects. I'm just going to show you two ways. One that you know, one that you may never seen before. So I can dig here inside the project, or I can use the keyboard shortcut, remember, that I've defined before, reveal layer in project. I just want to show you. This is so useful, because now I can actually see this is particle yellow, particles yellow, this is particle blue. So one way to work is to select the layer here in the timeline, hold down the Alt or Option key, and then swap it. But this means that I need, sorry, this one. I need to swap this guy, and then I need to select this layer, and I need to swap the other layer as well. I'm going to undo twice. I don't want to work so hard. And maybe I have this clip in other places in the project. So if I want to replace all the instances, regardless of how many times I've used them, what I can do is do the same number in the project panel. So in the project panel, I'm going to select particles blue, hold down the Alt or Option, and drag it on top of particles yellow. And just like that, I've replaced every instance in the entire project. So cool! And this is really a cool version of the same effect. So this is without the color treatment, and this is with. Looks much better, I think. Do you agree? Nod your head if you agree. Yeah, I want you to do it in the same pace, everyone. All right. Now. You don't need to. All right, but I'm here to show it to you, so I'm just going to take it to the beginning. And here it is. And of course, After Effects needs to chew through the entire thing because this is a little bit of a heavy compositing. But still, it was worth the process. We have time to one more thing, which wasn't in my slide. I'm going to show you, if you want, if you like, it's optional, I think that you will enjoy it, how to create an infinite zoom effect, right? It will do something with your mind. I'm not sure if it's safe, but let's try it. All right, so here I've got this layer that I've named my camera, and this is, of course, can be your camera as well. This is just a shape layer, nothing really exciting here. What I would like to do is create some sort of a loop animation, like I'm diving into it over and over again. So I might as well show you instead of talk about it. So I'll start by pressing S, and this is going to isolate the scale for the layer. I'll start by changing the scale to 50%, create a keyframe at the first frame, go to the last frame. You can also press End on your keyboard, and just make it disappear. So let's go with nice round number of 1000%. Now if I'm going to take it to the start and press spacebar, it kind of works, but not really. See that from this point onward, it just disappears. So the thing is that the animation is linear, right? And this is why this is happening. So you may think, well, you know what? You already told me that if I'm going to press F9, it's going to be much smoother. And you are correct. But the thing is that if I'm going to create a loop, it will look very weird because it will almost pause and then start again. It will not really be infinite. It will not have this continuous feeling. So instead, I'm going to return to what I had before, two linear keyframes. And I'm going to make sure that both of them are selected by clicking on the word scale, and then click on one of them, and from the keyframe assistant menu, I'm going to choose this command, exponential scale, okay? Which is another way to scale a layer. So this is a different kind of formula. Now, After Effects created keyframes at every frame of the animation, but look at this. This is now exactly what I was looking for. This is what I expected in my mind when I created it. So if this is not working for you, always remember you've got the exponential scale formula, which in this case is just a godsend. All right, so let's move on. I'm going to take camera, this camera, which is layer number one, and I'm going to duplicate it. Once again, by pressing Command D, the menu is over here. If you are a menu person, duplicate. Now, what I would like to do is use parenting to create the animation. So I'm first going to press U, making sure to delete all the keyframes. Then I'll go to the end of the timeline. And this is super important because parenting is sensitive to the timing. So if I'm going to parent it at the beginning of the timeline, it will yield different results. And parenting is basically going to do this thing. It's going to take all of the geometry options, which are all of the transform options, except of opacity. Opacity is not a transformation. It is here for you to not have an arbitrary, really, right? So it's just to save some room. But it will take everything that the father is doing, and it will inherit it to the children, right? So now the second camera is actually doing the same thing as the first camera. So it almost works. It's just that we have this weird hole in the middle, right? So the way to fix it, and once again, this is a formula. This will work with every footage, what I'm showing you now, is to duplicate it again. So I'm going to press Command or Control D to duplicate it again. And then I'm going to make sure to go to the beginning and remove the parenting, right? So I don't need the parenting in this case over here. But I will go, I know it doesn't make sense, but trust me, this is how it works, to the end, and I re-establish the parenting over here. So if you didn't really get it, it doesn't really matter. What matters is that it is working. So three layers, exponential scale, this is the takeaway. And parenting, sometimes at the beginning, sometimes at the end, this is what will get you through this endless looping behavior. And this also brings us to the end of this session. So before I'll take your questions, I just want to make sure that you'll see the rest of my presentation, which is very boring, but very useful. If you want more of me, you can take a snapshot of this website, what used to be lynda.com. It still is, but now it is under the LinkedIn Learning umbrella. And I've got more than 2 dozen courses over there for After Effects, as well as Cinema 4D, Illustrator, and other good stuff. I want to thank you. You are the flesh. And if you enjoyed this session, make sure to rate me, give me good rates so they will invite me again. And maybe you will also win an ebook or a ViewSonic monitor. Who knows? Thank you so much. If you have any questions, come see me.